Chapter 60, Fourth Year, October. When Lily's kisses were not forthcoming, James demanded that they extend the bet to last the whole year. Sirius, in turn, said that in that case it ought to be worth double the galleons, which turned Peter white. Remus once again registered his disapproval of the whole thing and demanded that they count him out. He had much better things to spend his time on, and would not be spending any more money than he needed to. The others would have to be happy with a chocolate frog each for Christmas, because he simply couldn't spare the cash. Remus knew that he would need every last nut the moment he turned 17 in order to begin his mission to find Greyback. His investigation had so far been fruitless. He had gathered up as many old editions of the Daily Prophet as possible, from the library, and lying about in the common room. Some of the more recent editions had articles which mentioned werewolf packs, but there was hardly any detail, and no names mentioned. In the end, Remus was forced to conclude that nobody really knew anything solid. He imagined werewolves were hard to find, especially if they were ordinary wizards most of the time. Asking Firox seemed like the next most sensible course of action. The Care of Magical Creatures teacher had suggested that he knew more than he'd initially revealed to Remus last term. Only Remus hadn't had the presence of mind to ask, still reeling from the news that Firox had worked for Lyle. He needed to work up the nerve before going back, however, and plan his questions carefully enough so that Firox wouldn't suspect anything. October began and ended with a full moon that year, which seemed very unfair, especially as it meant Remus would miss the Halloween feast. Still, the weather was unseasonably warm, and the Marauders spent most of their free time enjoying the grounds under the fair blue sky, surrounded by the golden reds and browns of the most beautiful autumn Remus could remember. On weekends, he would settle down in the Quidditch stands with several books, parchment and quills, and complete his homework and advance reading, occasionally glancing up to watch one of James's drills or cheer on poor Peter, who often got stuck as the stand-in keeper. Sometimes Marlene practiced with them, which made the afternoons even more pleasant, as Lily and Mary would inevitably pop by. Sirius was unable to sit still at all during these sessions. He alternated between trying to focus on his homework, to hopping onto his broom for a race with James, to scribbling down complex tactical plays he thought the Gryffindor team ought to use in their first game, scheduled for November. "We've got to thrash Slytherin this year," he kept muttering. "Got to show 'em." Slytherin had won the Quidditch Cup the year before, and it was an immensely sore spot with the Gryffindors, particularly Sirius, as both Narcissa and Regulus had been on the winning team. This year, it was only Regulus, who had replaced his older cousin as Seeker. Remus only knew this from James. Sirius had mentioned nothing. "You need to lean into your broom more when you take a swing," Sirius was telling Marlene, who had just sat down for a rest. She was red in the face, fair hair plastered to her damp temples, and not in the mood for Sirius's commentary. "I hit the bludgers 9 times out of 10, she replied, panting. 10 times in my best game. Even Mulciber can't manage that. "Don't try to be better than the competition," Sirius admonished piously. "You've only got yourself to beat. Look, Black, if you think you can do better, we're trying out for beaters on Tuesday." "Nah," he waved a hand, looking away. "You beat me fair and square." 2 years ago. He didn't respond, and Marlene just shrugged, then staggered to her feet and headed back to the pitch, where James was calling for her. Remus had been reading his book throughout this exchange, and hadn't wanted to interfere. He shot a glance at Sirius, who was leaning forward on the barrier, his chin resting on his arms as he watched the practice. Peter made a decent save, and Sirius's eyes lit up. Remus bit his lip and thought hard, before saying quietly, "There are 2 beaters on the Quidditch team, you know." "Bloody hell, Mooney," Sirius replied sarcastically, not taking his eyes off the pitch. 4 years and you finally learnt something about the game." Remus ignored that, only tutting under his breath. "You know your problem? Do tell." "You're proud," Sirius laughed. "And you're not." "Maybe, but I'd make a shit beater, wouldn't I?" Sirius went quiet again. Remus sighed heavily, closing his book, packing it into his bag. Look, you're gonna hate yourself later if you don't give yourself another crack at it.
You're just gonna sit here cheering James on for 3 more years.
He stood up.
I'm freezing. Off to the library. See you at dinner.
Yeah, see you, Mooney.
That Tuesday, Remus went along to watch the Gryffindor team trials and said nothing when he saw Sirius arrive, broom in hand. He didn't even smile smugly, though he dearly wanted to. 2 hours later, Gryffindor had their new beta, and Remus realised that now he had to share his dorm with 2 Jameses. Except for one very important difference. While Sirius was undoubtedly full of passion for the sport, he appeared to lack James's discipline, particularly in the mornings. "Wakey, wakey!" James chanted brightly as he exited the bathroom, hair shining and wet, the only time it ever lay flat on his head. He pushed on his glasses and flicked his wand at Sirius's bed, drawing back the curtains. It was a week after the trials, and this scene was becoming commonplace. Remus was already awake, almost dressed for breakfast, planning to get in an hour's reading before lessons started. He was tying up his shoelaces as he watched James and Sirius begin their new morning routine. Sirius, who was little more than a shapeless lump under the duvet, groaned like a disgruntled troll. "Piss off, Potter," he hissed, burying his head under the pillow. "You wanted to be on the team. Sirius, my old chum, come on, up you get. Levy corpus." With that, Sirius's body flew into the air, seemingly yanked by some invisible force, leaving him hanging upside down in midair, while James laughed hysterically. "I can't believe that worked. Been trying to do that since last Christmas." "Let me down, you wanker."
"Be nice."
"Let me down."
"Finite." Sirius landed on the floor with a thud and leapt up immediately, rubbing the arm he'd landed on.
"Bloody hell," he grinned at James. "That was amazing. Now let me do it on you."
"Okay." Bodily levitation did not become a regular fixture of the 4th-year boys' dorm, but trying to drag Sirius out of bed did.
"Just one day off a week, Potter. I'm begging you."
He groaned at the breakfast table one early Sunday morning. He barely opened his eyes, his lolling head propped up on his elbow.
"You're the one who wants to destroy Slytherin,"
James replied cheerily, buttering some toast and sliding it over to his friend. Sirius glanced down at the offering disdainfully and looked away, closing his eyes again. James sighed.
"Not just you, either. The whole school wants to see them beaten. Think of it as doing your bit for the war effort."
"I thought you were doing your bit by hexing them in the corridors," Remus said, helping himself to a slice of Sirius's toast.
"Exactly," Sirius grunted, eyes still closed. "And that can be done at a reasonable hour." "This is the only time we can fit practices in," James said, starting to sound a bit annoyed now. "There's no point going after dark. The pitch gets booked up in the evenings and lessons start at 9.
"Even if they started at 12, you'd have trouble getting Sirius up," Peter said, mouthful of porridge.
"We should get time turners," Sirius yawned, without a trace of humour. "Students who need their beauty sleep should be issued with them."
"What's a time turner?" Remus asked, taking Sirius's second slice of toast.
"Turns back time, obviously," Sirius said scathingly.
"They're illegal," James said quickly. "Without ministry permission. And really, really dangerous."
"I'm dangerous if I don't get enough sleep," Sirius grumbled.
"Matron used to make us all get up at 6 on weekends," Remus said thoughtfully, swallowing the last of his toast. "She thought it was healthy or something. One of the older boys got into her room once and fiddled with her alarm clock, though, and we got away with an extra 2 hours in bed every day for a week before she noticed."
"Muggles are ingenious," James chuckled.
"But stay away from my alarm clock."
"Hmm,"
Remus murmured, deep in thought. He could feel the beginnings of an idea coming on.
"Oh no, we've lost him," Sirius said, watching Remus. Probably daydreaming about Nogtails and Nifflers again. I swear, care of magical creatures is the only subject he cares about anymore. Leave Mooney alone and eat your breakfast, James chastised. I want you on the pitch in 5 minutes. Fine, Sirius sighed heavily and looked down at his plate. Oi, where's my breakfast? Got to go, Remus said, suddenly standing up. Library, see you in potions. Early mornings were Remus's favourite time in the library. Everything was so neat and tidy, and he usually had the place to himself. Very few students were in the mood to study first thing, but Remus had found that during certain phases of the moon, he barely slept 5 hours a night anyway, so he was a regular visitor. The idea took a while to form properly, but he wanted to be clear and complete before bringing it to the other marauders. Then at least it would be fully his prank. Remus felt the need to make his mark on something this year. Everyone else seemed to be focused on other things. The war, or Quidditch, or the Great Snogging Race, as Sirius had so eloquently dubbed it. They hadn't even tried to sneak to Honeydukes once. Remus felt very strongly that the marauders needed a prank, and a big one. He wasted half an hour researching complex and convoluted time spells, incantations to stop time, speed it up, slow it down, or even bend it. He wasn't really sure how bending time worked, but it didn't sound pleasant, or within his scope of ability. Eventually, he came to the conclusion that he was overthinking it, as usual. This was not a magical problem. It was mechanical. By the time the school day was about to start, Remus had located the passage he needed in Hogwarts A History, and was satisfied that he'd have a plan by the end of the week. He left the potions in a pretty good mood, one which was quickly shattered when he realised he was being followed. The feeling of being watched had been prickling the back of his neck while he'd been in the library, but as it was generally a quiet and solitary place anyway, he'd put it down to an overactive imagination. And there was always the chance that Madame Pince was lurking behind him, standing guard over her precious books. By 8:45, the hallways were crowded with students hurrying to their lessons, chattering and giggling, hurriedly eating breakfasts on the go, or scribbling down last-minute homework. Although this year's Remus's policy had been never to travel alone, he was satisfied that it was busy enough and there were enough Gryffindors around to be safe. However, as he began to descend the first set of stairs leading to the dungeons, the prickling feeling returned once more. As a rule, Remus tried to ignore instincts like that. They belonged to the wolf, and he resented the intrusion. But he couldn't shake it, and reached for his wand, gripping it tight. Finally, only a corridor away from the potions classroom, he made a deliberate wrong turn and darted behind a tapestry. He waited. Sure enough, only a few seconds later, Severus Snape peered around the corner, looking confused. Irritation boiled up in Remus's throat, and before he could think about it reasonably, he pointed his wand at the Slytherin and chanted, "Petrificus Totalus!" Snape went rigid, a look of surprise on his face that should have been comical, if Remus wasn't so angry. The black-haired boy fell to the ground, arms and legs straight as a board, completely paralysed. His beady black eyes stared around frantically as Remus stepped out from his hiding place. He gave him a kick, not too hard, only in the shin, and smirked down at Severus. "Stop following me, you creep," he said. "Didn't I warn you?" Snape stared helplessly at him, and Remus laughed before heading to potions with a spring in his step. Chapter 61, Fourth Year, November, Part 1. "Don't forget! I need that 3-page essay on the similarities and differences between Thunderbirds and Phoenixes on Friday at the latest," Professor Firrox called out. "No excuses!" Mary and Marlene groaned as they packed away their things. "I completely forgot about that," Marlene whispered. "And I've got practice almost every night this week. We've got the Ravenclaw match on Sunday." "I'll lend you my notes," Remus replied, carefully blotting his paper. It's really easy.
Sunday's Sirius's birthday too, isn't it? Mary asked thoughtfully.
Yeah? How do you know?
Well, we did sort of go out last year, Mary said haughtily, tutting at Remus. And you lot always make us such a massive fuss over birthdays, it's pretty hard to forget.
God, I hope Gryffindor win, or he'll be in a right mood.
Yeah, Remus agreed. He hadn't thought of that. He'd planned to reveal his prank on Sirius's birthday, in lieu of a proper gift. Now he wondered if he ought to buy something as well. Though, they weren't due in Hogsmeade for a few more weeks. He could always give Sirius a packet of cigarettes, but that seemed a bit cheap, especially as Sirius knew they were stolen. Andromeda had sent some presents ahead, care of the Potters, and James had kept them hidden under his bed. More records, of course. Remus dearly hoped that one of them was the new David Bowie LP, Diamond Dogs.
I'm off to the Owlery. Need to send something to Darren, Mary said as they left the classroom.
Coming, Mars. Marlene looked a bit put out, so Remus said quickly,
I'm going to the library if you want to get those notes.
Yeah, thanks, Remus. They said goodbye to Mary and began walking in the opposite direction together. Remus liked Marlene a lot. She was tall for a girl, and he didn't have to crane his neck down to talk to her all the time. Other than her emotional outburst at the end of their third year, she was also very much a non-nonsense person, which Remus found very calming compared to Mary, who was always a lot of fun, but sometimes very full-on.
Thanks, Marlene grinned at him.
I love the girl, but there's only so many times I can proofread her dirty letters to Darren.
Dirty letters?
Remus gaped. Marlene laughed.
Yeah, it's pretty horrendous.
Hey, Remus, can I ask you something?
What?
Does Sirius like me? Remus fought his initial reaction, which was one of despair. It felt as though he hadn't got through a week of the new year yet without having to listen to someone's romantic problems. Why did they all think he was the best person to talk to? When had he ever given the impression that he was even remotely interested?
I don't know, he said, hoping he didn't sound too annoyed.
You'd have to ask him.
I don't think he'd give me a straight answer, Marlene chuckled.
Sorry, it's just that he's been acting really weird around me during Quidditch practice.
Weird?
Yeah, just comments and stuff. It's a bit annoying, really. I don't really fancy him as much as I used to. You know, he's such an attention seeker. He was always much more Mary's type.
What comments?
Stuff about me giving him a kiss for luck or something. Maybe it's his idea of flirting, or maybe it's a joke. You never know with James and Sirius, do you?
It suddenly dawned on Remus what was going on, and he was half angry, half embarrassed for Sirius.
What? Marlene said, stopping just outside the library.
What's that face for?
Ugh, Marlene, look, I'm really sorry about this, but... And he explained to her all about the bet.
Okay, yes, she was quite likely to tell Mary, and Mary was extremely likely to tell everyone else in their year, but that would serve the boys right, in Remus's opinion. He took a distinct pleasure in ruining Sirius's chances at winning the stupid bet. Fortunately, Marlene was a very sensible girl, and by the end of Remus's explanation, she was giggling.
It makes so much sense, she said, wheezing. James kept trying to stop Sirius talking to me and everything.
Those boys, completely ridiculous.
Yeah, Remus grinned, relieved that someone else shared his opinion.
Oh, great, now I can have some fun with it, Marlene smirked. As they entered the library, lowering their voices, she then added a little wistfully,
Shame James hasn't tried it on. He might have a chance.
Remus raised his eyebrows.
Well, he's only got eyes for Lily, so...
Marlene sighed.
That's a losing battle. Still, never mind.
They settled down at their favourite desk, which was near to the biggest window and provided some nice natural light. Rumours pulled out his notes and showed Marlene how he'd listed all of the qualities of thunderbirds and phoenixes, and then how he'd begun to compare the two. Grateful for his help, Marlene offered up her astronomy notes, and the two of them spent a companionable hour scribbling away. Eventually, it was time for dinner.
"Remus," Marlene said quietly as they finished up, "are all the marauders in on this bet, or just James and Sirius?"
I think Peter's doing it. He might regret it a bit now, though."
"So you're not?"
"No," he replied, a bit more loudly than he'd meant.
"Shame," she replied, her eyes twinkling. "Because I bet you could win."
He snorted, as if.
"Girls like you. You're really nice and kind and clever."
"Shut up.
I'd snog you."
"Oh my god, Marlene." Rumors started walking a bit faster, his ears feeling very hot.
"You're my friend."
"Yeah, but just to win the bet," she grinned, matching his pace. He'd forgot how athletic she was, and he still had a dodgy hip.
"Isn't there anyone you fancy?"
"No. Go on, I'm hungry." It wasn't a lie, Rumors thought to himself. It sort of felt like it, though.
"Go, go, Gryffindor, go, go,"
Rumors chanted along with everyone else, having Peter wildly waving his scarf over his head like a lunatic with a knitted lasso helped negate any embarrassment Rumors might have felt for himself. He was nervous, though, more nervous than he had been for James and Marlene's first game, because Sirius, while of course very good at flying, did not always make the best decisions under pressure, and Quidditch was a dangerous sport if you were reckless. Half of the crowd was decked in blue, the other half in scarlet, and a deafening cacophony of boos and cheers erupted as the two teams walked onto the pitch. James was visible as ever with his wild mess of hair, and from a distance the two Gryffindor beaters were the same height, distinguishable only by their different coloured ponytails poking out under their helmets, one flaxen, one black. Rumours felt his heart in his mouth as the players mounted their brooms, squatted slightly, then launched into the air at the blow of the whistle. It was hard to know who to follow, as James zipped up and down the pitch like a lightning bolt in pursuit of the quaffle, while Marlene and Sirius split off, covering different ends of the pitch, bats aloft. The two beaters had very different styles. Marlene was focused and tended to tail the players rather than the bludgers in order to protect the teammates. Sirius favoured a different tact, going directly after the offending balls no matter where they were, and knocking them as far away from the game as possible.
"This is Black's first game, and he's obviously throwing himself into it," the commentator's voice echoed through the crowd. "He's no doubt received plenty of coaching from Potter, who's just scored the first goal. That's Gryffindor in the lead with 10 points.
Rumours was too anxious to cheer along with everyone else, getting dizzy trying to follow all three of his friends in the air.
"As I was saying," the commentator, a seventh-year Hufflepuff, continued, "lots of talent on the Gryffindor side this year. Potter, of course, and McKinnon, who's one of the best beaters the Reds have had in years. And now Sirius Black, the black sheep of a bona fide Quidditch dynasty. You'll remember his cousin, Narcissa Black of Slytherin, one of the finest seekers Hogwarts has ever seen. And, of course, the younger Black brother, Regulus, who has taken Narcissa's place after a season as chaser. Rumour has it there's bad blood in the Black clan, so you can bet the Gryffindor-Slytherin match next term is going to be...
If you will please focus on the game currently in progress, Miss Darcy,"
McGonagall snapped over the megaphone. "Sorry, Professor. So that's Dunholm of Ravenclaw in possession of the quaffle. She shoots, she... Oh, and it's a bad miss."
The game went on, and Rumours hoped that Sirius hadn't been listening to the commentary. Bringing up the Black family was a sure way to break his concentration. But no, all seemed well. He was hitting the bludgers with a bit more vigour, but that could just have easily been adrenaline. By the end of the game, it became evident that Remus's concerns were for nothing. Sirius may not act as though he took Quidditch seriously off the pitch,
But clearly having a cheering audience did wonders for his concentration. Once the Gryffindor sneaker caught the snitch, ending the match on 300 to 110 in Gryffindor's favour, the two beaters flew to the ground. Remus saw Sirius throw a gallant arm around Marlene's shoulders and lean in, only to be dodged deftly as she offered her cheek for him to kiss. The common room was a riot of red and gold and rock music that evening. The whole house came out to celebrate both Gryffindor's victory and Sirius's birthday. Remus, for what it was worth, sold more cigarettes than he had all year so far. He'd come prepared, assuming correctly that the older students would be drinking, making them more inclined to pay up for a hit of nicotine. He himself stayed away from any suspicious-looking drinks, remembering his hellish hangovers from the summer. Sirius and James were in their element, of course, roaring with laughter and soaking up the congratulations from their classmates. Peter hung about close enough to enjoy the limelight, but not so close as to get in the way. Remus was happy to watch at a distance, chatting with Lily and Mary and enjoying the snacks brought up from the kitchens. He knew he would not get a chance to divulge his plan until much later now, but that was okay. Better for everyone to enjoy themselves. There was plenty of time. At some point, Sirius finally got around to opening his presents. A broom repair kit from James, a lot of chocolate from Peter, and from a dromedaire, no less than three brand new albums, Dark Side of the Moon, Country Life, which had an incredibly rude cover that all the boys smirked and passed around and made Remus want to die of embarrassment, and Diamond Dogs. "Oh," Remus said, unable to contain his excitement as he held the much-awaited record in his hands, stroking the bizarre, nightmarish artwork. "Put this one on first, please."
Sirius grinned.
"Anything for you, Mooney," and settled the disc into the turntable. The record player howled, sending a shiver of shock down Remus's spine, the cry of a wolf. He stared up at James and Sirius in alarm. They looked just as surprised as he was, though Sirius broke into a smile as David Bowie's voice filled the room, as if speaking an incantation. The whole common room was uncomfortably quiet as this grim, ugly poem was recited, not quite sure where to look as dogs howled and whined in the background. It made Remus feel dark and dirty, but he thought he liked it, as if Bowie was speaking directly to him, especially as the final lines were yelling out, "This ain't rock and roll, this is genocide."
And in the death, as the last few corpses lay rotting on the slimy thoroughfare, the shutters lifted an ancient temperance building high on Poacher's Hill, and red mutant eyes gazed down on Hunger City. No more big wheels, fleas the size of rats sucked on rats the size of cats, and 10,000 peopleoids.
"A whole month," Sirius whispered loudly. "Yep, 30 days, James replied, in the same stage whisper. "If we do it over the summer."
"You forgot the silencing spell, idiots," Remus called out.
"Bugger." Lots of rustling. It was well past midnight on the day of Sirius's birthday, and the party had long since been broken up by the prefects. The marauders had climbed the stairs to bed, sleepy and excitable, but apparently James and Sirius had a second wind and were now in a private conference in James's bed. Remus had a pretty good idea what they were talking about, but had decided to leave them be for now. See how far they took it. Still, he knew they'd realise they'd forgotten the spell eventually, and decided honesty was the best policy. Remus and Sirius poked their heads out from behind their respective curtains at the same time.
"Sorry, Mooney," Sirius grinned. "Did we wake you?"
"Nah," Remus shrugged. "I was actually, I was thinking about this prank."
"Prank?" James's head joined Sirius's in the gap between the curtains.
"Who said prank?"
Remus smiled shyly.
He'd thought he might have to wait until next weekend to tell them, but James magnanimously opened the bed curtains further. "Please, Mr. Mooney," he said, "step into our office." Eagerly, Remus scrambled out from his tangle of bedsheets and padded barefoot across the chilly bedroom floor into James's bed. He felt as though he'd been waiting 4 years for an invite.
"Well?" James asked seriously, pointing his wand light at Remus like a microphone. "Tell us."
"Just a second." Remus rolled his eyes, withdrawing his own wand. "Muffliato."
"He's too clever for us," Sirius said dryly. "Indeed," James agreed. Remus ignored them. They were jumpy and silly from lack of sleep. He had to at least give them the gist of his plan before they finally crashed.
"Remember I was telling you about Matron's alarm clock?" he asked them quickly. The boys nodded obediently, like cocker spaniels. "And how we used to fiddle with it, so we didn't have to get up early anymore?"
More nodding.
"Well, I was thinking about it, and how it could be applied to Hogwarts. I did some research, and did you know that all of the clocks in this school were controlled by one master clock? The big one outside the Great Hall."
"Oh, Mooney!" Sirius cried, suddenly throwing himself at Remus, flinging his arms around him with such force that they both toppled backwards on the bed.
Startled, Remus tried to push him away, but Sirius held fast, pretending to sob on his shoulder with joy.
"You've read Hogwarts History! One of you has finally read it! You're now my favourite marauder!"
"Get off, Tosser!" Remus growled, finally forcing him off and shoving him further away on the bed.
James laughing at them both. "No one would ever guess you're the oldest, Black." James grinned. "Mooney, please continue. The big clock."
"Right, yeah." Remus straightened his nightshirt, feeling very hot and flustered from the assault. I had this idea. It was no good. He'd completely lost his train of thought. Now all he could think about was what an irritating idiot Sirius was.
"The big clock controls all of the others,"
Sirius filled in quickly, remarkably lucid now.
"It's a spell that makes sure every clock and watch in the castle is perfectly synchronized, even the ones we bring home to reset even muggle clocks. It's a bloody good bit of magic."
"Yeah," Remus nodded, getting back into the flow. "Yeah, exactly. So I'm thinking, if that clock goes wrong or gets moved by 5 minutes, then so do all the others. And it would affect lesson times and meals and, well, pretty much the whole running of the castle. And if we started off really slowly, say, moving it forward 5 minutes a night, no one would notice for ages, would they? I mean, how could anyone notice if all the clocks are the same?"
He finished, sitting back and looking at James, because he was still annoyed with Sirius for flustering him and almost spoiling it. James's brain was working at warp speed. Remus knew this because he had pushed his glasses back onto his nose. Finally, he looked at Sirius and smiled. "Our Mooney's done it again." Chapter 62, Fourth Year, November, Part 2. Monday, the 4th of November, 1974.
"I don't know," Peter said, wringing his hands again. "Professor McGonagall says we shouldn't mess about with time."
"Oh, we won't be," Sirius groaned, having already explained the plan twice.
"This is a muggle prank, Peter. Get it through your thick skull."
"Don't," Remus frowned, feeling sorry for Peter, who had been sulking all day anyway because he'd been left out of their nighttime planning.
"We're not messing about with time, Peter," Remus explained kindly. "We're just messing about with clocks."
Peter looked at Remus, then at James for confirmation.
"Okay," he said slowly. "I think I get it."
They'd agreed to do it as soon as possible, and struggled to get through their lessons that day with the mounting anticipation for their devious scheme. Remus had to shush James and Sirius more than once when their excitement got the better of them,
They were hardly subtle at the best of times.
It won't work if everyone else knows about it,
Remus hissed at lunch when Mary asked what they were whispering about.
So shut up. I know you lot can keep a secret if you really try.
They could hardly wait for the night to fall and the castle to grow still and quiet. It had been a long time since they had been all out of bounds together at dark, and even though it was a very simple task, all of them wanted to go. There was one problem. It was much more difficult to get all four of them under the cloak than it had been 3 years ago.
Peter, you stay here, Sirius said, after their third attempt.
Why me? Peter protested.
Why am I always the one left out?
We're not leaving you out, idiot. This is purely a logistical concern. Sirius rolled his eyes.
James!
I'll stay, Remus offered. I'm the tallest, it's my fault.
But it was your idea, Sirius whined. You can't miss out.
Remus shrugged.
There'll be lots of times. We're doing this more than once.
Even with three, it's a squeeze, James said. Black, Pettigrew, sit this one out.
Why me?
Sirius and Peter both cried at the same time.
Because, James said, lips curling.
It's Mooney's idea, and my cloak.
It took a little more squabbling, ego massaging, and many promises that every night they would take it in turns, just to be fair, before the two rejected marauders conceded.
Soon afterwards, Remus and James were creeping through the Gryffindor common room under the cloak, tiptoeing past a few sleeping seventh years lying unconscious on their newt textbooks.
Hopefully they'll stop squabbling if we give them an hour alone,
James whispered as they left the portrait hall and entered the dark empty corridor.
Why is Sirius being such a dickhead to Peter anyway?
Remus asked, his own voice as low as possible. They didn't want to disturb Peeves, or even worse, Mrs. Norris.
All the girls know about the great snogging race,
James replied, moving slowly so that Remus could keep pace.
Sirius thinks Pete told them.
Why do you think that?
You know Black,
James said with a smile in his voice.
Loves jumping to conclusions. Usually the wrong ones.
You don't think it was Peter then?
Remus asked innocently.
Mooney, James snorted. I know it was you. Doesn't bother me,
James laughed quietly.
If anything, it's improved my chances of winning the bet.
Marlene offered to snog me, Remus said suddenly. But I told her I wasn't in the bet.
He wasn't sure why he'd chosen to tell James, or why he'd picked such an inopportune moment to do so. He supposed he just wanted someone to know. Maybe it was a boasting thing. They were the ones who hadn't included him in the running in the first place.
Ha,
James said. Don't tell Sirius. He'll never get over it.
She'd snog you, Remus added charitably. She told me she would.
Alas, it's not to be,
James replied casually. Remus was thoughtful for a little while. They had reached the clock now, at the bottom of the grand staircase. It was very big and very beautiful, with a vast mahogany frame carved with various magical creatures and plants, the face and hands cast in shimmering gold. Remus pulled out his wand and concentrated carefully on unbinding the protective charms placed there by a great wizard long time ago. It took a long time. They were complex and intricate, braided together fine as lace. But slowly and surely, one by one, he felt the magic unfasten with a gentle pop somewhere in his midsection. He smiled at James.
There we go.
James waved his own wand at the clock, and the long hand rolled backwards 5 minutes. He looked down at his own watch, and they both saw it synchronize. James chuckled under his breath.
See, Mooney?
I knew it had to be you. Come on, better get back. They crept back up the stairs, quicker now, giddy with triumph. At the top, Remus had to pause for breath for a moment. He rested a hand on James's shoulder to steady himself, and the other boy waited patiently.
Hey, James.
Yeah?
Are you really going to lose the bet to Sirius for Lily's sake?
James's back stiffened slightly, but he didn't sound annoyed.
Might not lose. But Lily's never gonna.
I'm the one taking divination, Lupin, not you.
Yeah, but she hates you.
She doesn't hate me, James chuckled. Lily Evans doesn't have a hateful bone in her body. Rumor said nothing to this, knowing it was quite true. James continued,
It's just not time yet, that's all. But I don't mind.
Oh, Rumor said. It struck him for the first time that James didn't simply fancy Lily. It was something else altogether. Rumors wanted to ask more questions, but he didn't know how. He wasn't serious. He couldn't be that brazen. When they got back to the bedroom, Sirius was pacing the floor and the curtains were drawn around Peter's bed. It could be assumed that they had not used the time to settle their differences.
Well?
Sirius barked eagerly as James and Remus threw off the cloak.
Done,
James said simply, yawning and heading for his own bed. He patted Sirius on the shoulder as he passed him. Enjoy your 5 minutes lie-in. And so the prank went on. Every night that week, two marauders would creep downstairs under the invisibility cloak and perform the spell to move that minute hand back by 5 degrees. So that by Saturday morning, every clock at Hogwarts was running 25 minutes late. So far, no one seemed to have noticed, and James and Sirius were getting restless.
The thing is,
Sirius yawned over breakfast, sleepy-eyed in his rumpled Quidditch kit.
We're not actually getting an extra half hour's sleep, are we? We're not going to bed any earlier.
No, well, that wasn't the actual intention, Remus said, attempting to construct a marmalade and strawberry jam toast sandwich.
Still, I think we ought to be getting something out of it.
The satisfaction of a job well done, Remus responded dryly, before biting into his creation. Sweet fruit jelly oozed from between the crusts, getting all over his fingers. Sirius grimaced. He had an aversion to sticky things. The brilliance of their own genius was apparently not enough for Sirius, however. The next morning, Remus woke up a long time before his alarm. And he checked his bedside clock, and he saw that it was apparently still 7 a.m. He went over and shook Sirius.
What did you do last night?
Remus asked, once Sirius finally woke up.
You and James did the clock, didn't you?
Fancied a bit more of a lie-in, that's all.
How much did you move it by?
I don't know, hour or two.
What?
What? Sirius looked genuinely surprised. Isn't that the whole point of the prank?
Well, Remus sighed. What was the point? It couldn't go on forever, anyway.
It's still too much. I'm going to go see if I can turn it forward a little bit tonight. Sirius shrugged, rolled over, and went back to sleep. A few people commented on how odd it was to wake up in broad daylight in the winter at 7 o'clock in the morning. But as it was a Sunday anyway, Remus thought they'd got away with it. That evening, Remus and Peter crept downstairs as usual, and Remus tried to correct Sirius's recklessness.
Can we make it so that we get up earlier next Saturday?
Peter asked uncertainly. Remus still wasn't sure that Peter fully understood what they were doing.
Don't see why not, Remus shrugged. Why do you want to get up earlier, though?
It's, a Hogsmeade weekend, and I was going to meet, no, nothing.
Who?
Please don't tell James or Sirius.
Who, Pete?
Desdemona Lewis.
Oh, no, I won't tell anyone.
Remus went to bed with a heavy heart that night. He felt he had lost every one of his friends now. The only one who didn't constantly want to talk about relations with the opposite sex was Lily, and he felt a bit guilty around Lily, since inadvertently ruining their potions project.
To be fair, everyone's in the class had been ruined.
Oh dear, Professor Slughorn had scratched his head, completely confounded by the useless girding potions everyone had produced.
Did everybody leave them to brew for the correct amount of time? It must be precisely 24 hours.
Everyone had, of course, or thought they had. It was really Sirius's fault, Remus told himself. Sirius, of course, found the entire episode immensely amusing, and it only inspired him to make greater risks. The problem was, Remus couldn't catch him at it. Every time it was Sirius's turn to go down and change the clocks, he made sure he was going either with Peter or James. And whenever Remus volunteered to go, Sirius took a step back.
I know what you're doing, Remus told him, when they woke up one morning with the sun already at its highest point in the sky.
And I know what you're doing, Sirius replied with a grin. Goody Two Shoes.
It was true. Remus was going down every second night and trying to fix whatever havoc Sirius had caused, so that by the third week of November, the clocks were all swinging wildly this way and that, sometimes altered by as much as 4 hours. The main problem was that Sirius wouldn't tell him how much he was changing the time by, so Remus was having to guess at his corrections.
What the hell is going on? Mary said one morning at breakfast, after perhaps only 4 hours' sleep.
Remus regretted that, but it had been the only way to reclaim ground in Sirius's ridiculous tug of war. Breakfast had become a very odd event. It seemed that the house elves in the kitchen were more confused than anyone else about the time of day, and were in disagreement over which meal they ought to be serving. As such, scrambled eggs were being served alongside mashed potatoes and gravy, legs of lamb accompanied cornflakes, and once or twice everyone had arrived for dinner, and nothing at all had appeared. Sirius and James were loving every minute of this, of course.
What do you mean? James asked nonchalantly.
Sirius was not speaking that morning, only yawning and occasionally scowling at Remus.
Isn't anyone else sleeping really badly? Mary asked desperately.
She was starting to look quite frazzled. Her dark hair was coming out of her braids in thick corkscrews, and her eyes were slightly bloodshot.
And what's up with the weather?
Yeah, it was really dark yesterday, Marlene yawned.
But today it started getting light at 6 or something.
Hogwarts is a very mysterious and magical place, James said. Who are we to question its inner workings?
Meanwhile, Remus was very concerned about the upcoming full moon. He thought it was due soon, but he couldn't really be sure. If Sirius didn't slow down, he might lose track altogether and just have to lock himself in the Shrieking Shack for a week. He didn't know how to explain that to Madame Pomfrey, but if he didn't do something, then he ran the risk of transforming somewhere in the castle. Wednesday, the 27th of November, 1974. By the fourth week, Remus didn't think any of the Marauders knew what on earth the time was supposed to be, even in the vaguest sense. He'd given up trying to correct Sirius at all, and instead thought it best just to let things play out. Things finally came to head when, while yawning their way through a transfiguration lesson, Peter suddenly looked out of the window with a gasp.
"What is it, Pettigrew?" McGonagall snapped.
She had been much more irritable than usual. Actually, everyone had, and Remus resolved never to muck up anyone's sleep pattern again.
Nothing, Professor.
Peter looked down hurriedly. But it was too late. The whole class, including McGonagall, was now staring out of the window too, and watching the sunrise at 11 o'clock in the morning.
"Oh, for goodness sake," McGonagall said. "Class, I want you all in the Great Hall at once, and getting the headmaster."
Less than an hour later, Remus was feeling extremely nervous, surrounded by the rest of the school as they waited for Dumbledore to address them. He hadn't seen much of the headteacher that year. The old man was often absent for meals now, and McGonagall had said he was simply out on business for ministry. Still, he was here now,
and Remus couldn't stop the sinking feeling in the pit of his stomach as the white-haired wizard approached the lectern.
"What's going on, do you think?"
Lily asked Remus. Mary was snoozing on her shoulder.
"No idea," he replied, hoping he sound convincing.
"It seems..." Dumbledore began.
He spoke very softly for a teacher, Remus had always thought, but somehow everyone fell quiet anyway.
"That we have some pranksters in our midst."
At once, everyone in the room turned to look at Remus, Sirius, James and Peter. Remus kept staring ahead, ignoring them. Peter began to shake his knee anxiously, glancing at James, who smiled back at his audience in an affable manner. Remus couldn't see what Sirius was doing, but it was sure to be ridiculous and highly disrespectful. Still, Dumbledore made no accusations, only smiled pleasantly and continued,
"Rest assured that the clocks are now being corrected, and measures taken to ensure that this cannot happen again. In the meantime, I think we could all do with a bit of rest. I am cancelling the rest of today's lessons to be resumed at our usual and correct time tomorrow morning."
There was a collective murmur of appreciation at this news.
"Yes," Sirius hissed. "Result!"
"Now," Dumbledore raised his arms. "Off you go. Use this time wisely."
Everyone in the hall got to their feet and began to trudge wearily towards the doors. The marauders were just about to follow suit when McGonagall appeared behind them, placing a hand on Sirius and James's shoulders.
"Wait," she said. "Not you four."
Remus gulped as the rest of the school vacated the room until it was just the four of them, Dumbledore and McGonagall.
"So," Dumbledore smiled kindly, "which one of you came up with the idea? Or was it a collective effort?"
The four boys looked at each other, then down at their laps. Dumbledore chuckled.
"Admirable," he said approvingly. "Then we shall have to treat you all equally. I think 10 points each from Gryffindor. Do you agree, Professor McGonagall?"
"At the very least," she nodded. "And attentions."
"I shall leave that in your capable hands, then. Just one thing, boys."
They all looked up, wincing as they braced themselves for the telling off.
"You're all clearly very gifted wizards," Dumbledore continued to smile.
Peter gave an odd sort of squeak.
"That much is clear. It was a simple spell, yes, but highly effective. That kind of thing will take you far. But perhaps a little more forethought and planning next time. You might not have been discovered quite so quickly."
3 weeks isn't bad,"
Sirius blurted out. James kicked him, but Dumbledore laughed, and McGonagall turned red with anger.
"Then it shall be 3 weeks' detention, Black."
Sirius quickly bowed his head, and James muttered under his breath, "Idiot." End of chapter 62.